All right, can you hear me now? Okay, good. All right, now before we get started, I just want to ask everybody for a quick round of applause for Raj Kaparnan, the director of the Center for Entrepreneurship and Free Enterprise, and the man that is responsible for this whole conference. I now have the pleasure of introducing our final speaker for the Road to Freedom Seminar, Stephen Moore. Mr. Moore is the Distinguished Visiting Fellow for the Project for Economic Growth at the Heritage Foundation. Mr. Moore, who is also a member of the Wall Street Journal's editorial board, returned to Heritage in January of 2014, about 25 years after his tenure at the leading conservative think tank's Fellow in Budgetary Affairs from 1984 to 1987. As Distinguished Visiting Fellow at Heritage, Mr. Moore focuses on advancing public policies that increase the rate of economic growth to help the United States retain its position as the global economic superpower. He also works on budget, fiscal, and monetary policy and showcases states that get fiscal houses in order. He holds a Master of Arts in Economics from George Mason University, and his early career was shaped by three people who had a profound influence on him. Julian Simon, the late Cato Institute scholar, Edwin J. Follner, a co-founder of Heritage, and Art Laffer, the economist best known for the Laffer Curve and co-author of Rich States, Poor States. He was a consultant to the National Economic Commission in 1987, research director for President Reagan's Commission on Privatization, and one of the top economic advisors for President Donald Trump's campaign, playing a significant role in passing the 2017 tax cuts. He calls his creation of the Club for Growth the defining moment of his career, and the organization which he left in 2004 helps elect conservative members to Congress. Mr. Moore next founded the Free Enterprise Fund before joining the Wall Street Journal, and as senior economics writer for the newspaper's editorial board, he covered Washington policy debates and state issues. Mr. Moore regularly speaks to Young America's Foundation student audiences at YAF conferences, as well as at campus lectures across the country. Any student can request to host Mr. Moore at their campus. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Stephen Moore.
Thank you. Thanks for the nice introduction. Do I need that? Oh, no, I've got, okay. Hi, everybody. You must be so excited. It's a Saturday night. You get to hear from an economist. It just doesn't get any better than this, right? By the way, are there any economics majors? Oh, wow. Awesome. Okay, so good. I'll be speaking your language today. How many of you watch Fox News in this room? How many of you watch CNN? How many of you watch MSNBC? So you're in the wrong room. I'm just kidding. No. So I did 6 years with Fox News, and that was a lot of fun. And a year ago, I switched over to fake news. I'm now with CNN, so that's a challenge. But you know, it's become the kind of it's really become the hate Trump network. And so, you know, I go on, and I'm usually up against four or five, you know, economists on the other side, and you know, those are pretty good odds for me. I like that. But so what I wanted to do, I thought I might have kind of a little fun with you tonight and talk to you a little bit. I mean, obviously we're going to talk about economics, but I thought I'd tell you a little bit about Donald Trump. I mean, are you guys interested in Trump and what he's like and that kind of thing? So you know, I've been reflecting a lot about this because it was about 2.5. By the way, let me just start by asking you all another question, and be honest. You know, there's no right or wrong answer to these questions. How many of you in this room have a positive opinion of Donald Trump? How many of you have a negative opinion of Donald Trump? A few of you. So it's about 2-1. But look, I've always said with Donald Trump, there is a good and a bad and an ugly. You know, he's like the classic cartoon character with an angel on one shoulder and a devil on the other. And when I say my prayers at night, I pray that the angel prevails over the devil. So there's, you know, with any politicians, there's really good things about Trump, and there's some things that I don't like about him. But I'll kind of take you back to when I first met him, which was about 2.5 years ago, back in at the beginning of the presidential campaign in 2016. It wasn't the very beginning, but Larry Kudlow, who, by the way, is now the chief economist for Trump, which is pretty cool, is best man at my wedding. He's my best friend in the world. He and I got a call from Corey Lewandowski if we wanted to go meet with Donald Trump. And you know, when Donald Trump first announced that he was running for president, I kind of rolled on the, you know, on the ground laughing. You know, I thought it was just a publicity stunt. You know, Donald Trump is going to run for president, and I didn't take it seriously. I think most people didn't really take it seriously, and I started observing, you know, what was happening with Trump, and you know that he just raced to the head of the polls, and that astounded everyone because it was a pretty strong field of Republicans running for president in 2016. You had Jeb Bush from Florida. How many Floridians? In the room, I know there's some. You know, your great former governor Jeb Bush, and then you had Marco Rubio, your senator from Florida, and you had any Ohioans in the room? John Kasich from Ohio, and you had Ben Carson, the great surgeon, and just I think there were like 15 candidates, and they all had people said this is the strongest field of Republicans to run in 50 years, and Donald Trump, who had no political experience, races out to the lead in the polls, and I got kind of interested in what's going on here. You know, what is the attraction of voters to this kind of reality TV star, successful businessman turned reality TV star? And I'll never forget, we went over to meet Trump in person in Trump Tower, Larry and I, and we walked in the room. And I have to say, when I walked in that room to meet Trump, I did not have a positive opinion of him. I thought he was kind of a publicity hound. I didn't like his persona on TV. He seemed like kind of, just intentionally saying the most flamboyant things just to get, attention and so on. And we walked in the room and we spent an hour with him talking about economics. And I got to tell you, I walked out of that room like with stars in my eyes, because how many of you in this room have ever met Donald Trump personally? Have any of you? A couple of you have. Trump is, an amazingly charismatic guy. I've always said, there's three. I've met politicians. I've been in politics a long time. I've been in politics for 35, 40 years almost. And I have the privilege of having worked with Ronald Reagan, so I met Reagan, and I knew Clinton, and I knew Bush, and I knew all the, most of all, I met Obama, I met all the congressmen and senators and, governors and so on, not all of them, but many of them. And so I've met a good deal of politicians over my lifetime, and I've always said there were three of them that I met, in my 30-some years in covering politics that really rose above the rest in terms of their ability to, light up a room when they walked in and just connect with the American people. Ronald Reagan, Bill Clinton, Barack Obama. There was just something about those three. They had this electricity about them that connected with the American people. And I was, I love Ronald Reagan, by the way. I think Reagan belongs on Mount Rushmore. I think he was one of our great, great presidents. But even Reagan couldn't hold a candle to Bill Clinton as a politician. And Bill Clinton was probably the best politician I ever saw. I've always said, Bill Clinton is the kind of guy who could literally and figuratively charm your pants off. But Trump, the reason I mention that is because Trump has this. It's this kind of X factor. It's hard to explain, but he just has this. He lights up a room when he walks in the room. By the way, Reagan, was like 6'3", huge, a big man. And Trump is a big guy, too. I mean, he looks like a football player and in incredible great shape. Anyway, to make a long story short, we walked into that room. And I remember Larry and I walked out of the room he could not have been nicer. It could have been more gracious, more attentive, more interesting to talk to. And we walked out of the room and we just looked at each other like, my God, this guy could actually win this thing. He just has that X factor. And so that's how, when we signed up to work for Trump to help him on the economic stuff. And he had asked us at that meeting if we would serve as senior economic advisors of the campaign. And we thought long and hard about it. And then Donald Trump is a hard person to say no to. So we agreed to do it. And it was a really kind of a fun experience. But I'll just tell you kind of a couple fun things from the campaign. I mean, so when we started, working with Trump, I'll never forget the first time we went on Trump's plane, because Trump, this was not Air Force One, this was during the campaign, but Trump obviously had his own plane. And I was kind of excited about this. I get excited about this stuff, and I was like, this is going to be great. He's a billionaire. We're going to have lobster and caviar and champagne and all this stuff. And, we get on the plane, and by the way, Trump is such a nice, he really is a kind of a really great guy. And I'll never forget the first time we walked on the plane. He like literally puts his arm around me. He's like, Steve, isn't this the greatest plane you've ever seen in your life? He's going out of the, do you want to see the cockpit? And blah, blah, blah. And I said, I've seen better. I'm just kidding. But, so he's, he's just full of life. And, so I'm thinking, because that's the other thing about Trump. His love him or hate him. I mean, this guy, how old is Trump? 70, 71 years old, something like that. I've never met anybody in my life with more energy than Donald Trump. I mean, seriously, this guy is like a freak of nature. he's just like the energizer buzzing. He goes on and on and on. And we would do events with him. You know, typical day, you'd do like 3 or 4 cities in a day. You know, you fly one place, you get off the plane, you do these events, blah, blah, blah. And it was totally exhausting, you know, for us as aides. And we weren't the ones going out there on the stage giving these speeches and stuff like that. And he would just go on and on. And you didn't have time when you were doing these events, you didn't have a lot of time to eat, or you know, you just literally get off the plane, get in the motorcade, you go over to the event, you do the event, you get back in the car, da, da, da. And so you know, you'd be really hungry, and I was like, yeah, well, I wonder what we're gonna have for you know, for food, for lunch and dinner. Same cuisine every single time. McDonald's, Big Macs for lunch, and Pizza Hut for dinner. It never, you know, and the guy loves fast food. You know, he's a man of the people. And the other kind of funny thing is, like on the plane with him, it was kind of fun because, you know, on the front section of the plane is where all the Secret Service people are sitting. And then in the middle sort of section is where you have the kind of area with the couches and where Trump sits, you know, at his table and gets stuff. And then in the front section is where he has his little bedroom. If he gets tired, he goes off into his bedroom and sleeps. And, you know, it's really funny. He had a TV on, you know, about this size, you know, in that area where we'd all convene. And he'd always be facing the TV. Now, what do you think he was watching? What do you think he watches?
Fox News.
Fox News. I mean, 24/7. Every once in a while he'll flick to see what the other shows are saying. But so we'd be having these sophisticated discussions about, here's the tax plan, here's what we're going to do about regulation and trade and all this stuff and blah, blah, blah. And, you know, every 5 minutes he'd go, shut up, because he'd see his face, you know, on the TV. He goes, I want to see what they're saying about it. And I'm like, Donald, you're on TV every 2 minutes, you know? I mean, you really have to hear what they're saying about it. But, you know, he was a quick study on this. We worked on the tax plan with him. Some of you may have heard me tell this story, but one of my favorite stories of the campaign, because at the beginning we were kind of traveling around with Trump, but towards the end of the campaign we were doing what we call surrogate activity. So we were doing events for Trump because he couldn't be everywhere at all times. And there were about 20 of us that would do events for him. And they sent me to this little town in Ohio because Ohio was a key state, right? We had to win Ohio. There was no way to win the election without winning Ohio. And so I'll never forget this. They fly me into Dayton, Ohio. And we got in a car, and this event was on the Ohio-Indiana border. And those were two crucial states, Indiana, Ohio. And when you get out of Dayton, I don't know if any of you have ever done this, but you go, when you drive through Ohio, Ohio is actually a very, you think of it as a Rust Belt industrial state, but Ohio actually is a very agricultural state, and there's all these little charming little rural farm towns, and you're just driving. We're driving through these, meandering through these little towns, and a lot of them are so small they didn't even have stoplights, and a lot of them didn't even have a Burger King or a McDonald's. And I'm just, as we're going through these charming little towns, I'm looking out the window, just observing, you know, what's going on in these towns. And honest to God's truth, as soon as we got out of Dayton, every single every second or third house, same thing. Trump, 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 Trump. I mean, the yard signs. And these weren't the signs that the campaign, you know, hands out to people. People were spray painting, you know, Trump on pieces of wood and putting out in their yard. I remember some of the big barns, TRUMP, and huge letters on the side. And, you know, it was amazing because, you know, after about 40 minutes of driving along like this, I called up the campaign and I said to the guy who's running the campaign, I said, you know, this is an amazing thing. We're driving through Ohio and all I'm seeing is Trump signs. And I said, I'm talking to my driver, Jimmy, too. I'm saying, you know, this is amazing. All I've seen is Trump signs. I said, I haven't seen one Hillary sign. Now, one Hillary sign in the last 35 minutes. And so sure enough, as soon as the words are out of my mouth, we go around the corner and sure enough, there's one of those big blue Hillary signs. So I said to Joey, never mind, Joey, there's one of them. Well, we drive a little closer, and Jimmy said, hey, Steve, take a closer look at that sign. And said, Hillary for prison. And I knew we were kind of in good shape on that. But, you know, it was an amazing upset. I would argue, by the way, one of the takeaways of that election, because it was, I would argue it might have been, and maybe even probably was, the single biggest upset in American history. Politically. You know, when I got started with Trump, I mean, he was a laughingstock. People would say he has zero chance of winning. Even on election night, I'll never forget this. Election night was one of the great nights of my life. But I'll never forget at 8 o'clock when the polls shut down on the East Coast, on MSNBC, Hillary's chief pollster went on MSNBC and she said, based on the exit polling data that we have, we believe that that Hillary has a 95% chance of winning tonight, a 95% chance. So they thought they had a lock on it. Almost all the political consultants, all the people get paid a lot of money to figure these things out. They almost, with a very few rare exceptions, almost all of them had it wrong, right? And how many of you are familiar with the metaphor of the black swan? How many of you heard of the black swan? So the black swan, for those of you not familiar with this, a black swan is a metaphor for an event. It's a story of someone who lives on an island and all he ever sees is white swan, right? And so he doesn't believe there are such things as black swans because he's never seen a black swan. All he's ever seen is a white swan. And so you believe that things that happen over and over again, and when the crowd says something is going to happen, there's a black swan event is an event that happens when everyone says it can't happen, right? And so this was, I always said that the election of Donald Trump was the ultimate political black swan event. You know, all the people said he could not win. Most of them said he would get trounced. He was going to lose 40 states. It was going to be the biggest blowout election. You remember this. There's the biggest blowout election ever in the history of, you know, American politics and so on and so forth. And yet Trump defied all of the critics, right? Not just the critics, but also the experts, the pros. As I said, the people are paid millions of dollars on this. Now, why is that important? Because I think one of the most important lessons of the election of 2016 is this. And it's a great, great lesson for you, no matter what you go into, whether you go in business or finance or politics or academia or science or whatever area you might go into. Sometimes, and more often than you might think in life, the experts are completely wrong. So when you're taking your classes and, you know, the professor says, all the experts say such and such is happening, or all the experts agree on this, it's amazing how many times all the experts are wrong. That's why I get so fed up with people saying, all of the experts say that climate change is happening. Well, maybe it's happening, maybe it's not happening, but it is not true that all the experts say that climate change is happening. Many of them, probably the majority of them do, but there's a minority of very influential scientists who say that it's all a bunch of, you know, it's just a, you know, bunch of junk that they're, junk science they're putting out. Now, I'm not saying that global warming is happening or is not happening, I'm just saying it's a fallacy to say there's some kind of scientific consensus. And even if there is a scientific consensus, that doesn't mean something is going to happen, because there was a huge political consensus that these other things were going to happen. So that's the takeaway from the election. Now, I wanted to talk to you about free market economics. And one of the ways I thought I would do that is kind of walk you through what Trump has done and, you know, what his policies have been and so on. And then I'm going to take some, you know, whatever questions you have, and happy to talk about, you know, whatever's on your mind. But I want to kind of walk you through this. Okay, so let's start with this. First of all, why were people angry? You know, why was there, one of the things I observed in the being on the campaign trail in 2016, and if you want to really understand what's going on in America, I mean, I had the time of my life being on the campaign, because you really get to see America. You go to West Virginia, you go to Kentucky, you go to Illinois, you go to Ohio, and you know, this is such a great country, you know, that every state has its own kind of personality and culture and language and political perspective on things, different industries, and so you know, what was one of the things that was interesting about this election was that the liberals kept saying, oh, everything's so wonderful after 8 years of the Messiah as president, everything's so wonderful in the United States today, right? And you know, how could anybody complain about this wonderful economy and this wonderful country that the Barack Obama has given us? And actually, see, this is another example of, you know, people sort of self-deluding themselves. Now, why did they believe that? Well, because where do most of these people in the media and, you know, the kind of elites live? Well, a lot of them live here in Washington, D.C., right, the bubble. And 3 out of 5 of the richest counties in America today are in Washington, D.C. I don't know how many of you know that. But think about that, by the way. That's a really amazing statistic. 3 of the 5 wealthiest places in America are here in the Washington, D.C. area. How did that happen? We don't produce anything, right? All we produce here in Washington is laws and legislation and you know, lobbyists and rules and edicts and so on, and we're getting rich at the expense of the rest of the country. That's why, by the way, what was Donald Trump's closing argument in the election?
Drain the swamp.
Drain the swamp. And boy, was that a powerful message to the American people. They're on to the joke here that these people, there's an old saying about Washington, this is a town that people come to do good and they end up doing well. And it's really true. You know, people get rich in this game, but they're not helping the rest of America. So there was a huge animosity out there, when I say out there, outside the Washington Beltway towards Washington, D.C. And by the way, Washington, D.C. is boomed during the Obama years. Hollywood boomed during the Obama years. Silicon Valley boomed during the Obama years. Wall Street boomed during the Obama years. But when you went to places like Pennsylvania, Ohio, Michigan, you know, those middle America states that Trump won, and I remember I would talk to the voters. I loved going out and just talking to the voters in these states, and I'd say, how is the recovery going for you? You know what these people would say? What recovery are you talking about? Because there were whole areas of the country where there was no recovery. And this kind of picks it up. So this shows you this black line in the bottom. This is the Obama recovery. Remember, Obama comes into office in January of 2009, where we faced this catastrophic financial crisis thanks to, in no small part, to George Bush and the Republicans that did nothing to stave off this financial crisis. And by the way, Bush's last 2 years in office were a total disaster, total disaster. Everything that Bush did in response to the financial crisis made it worse. And you had these massive bailouts and so on. So that's when Obama comes into office, and the recession officially ended in June of 2009, so about 6 months after he was elected. You know, there's a cycle to these things. When you have a recession, normally, you have a lot of people lose their jobs, and then the economy picks up again and makes up for the lost ground. And so what we measure here is how much did the economy grow in the 8 years after that recession. And you can see it grew about 15%, which was a little less than a 2% compounded rate of growth. That's not terrible. I mean, the economy did recover, but you can see it's a pretty shallow and anemic recovery. And then this light blue line is how the economy did, because we've had like 8 or 9 recessions since the end of World War II. I mean, there's a business cycle here, right? And the normal recovery is about 29%. And then I really love to compare what happened with Obama with Reagan. If you want to really annoy your liberal friends, compare the recovery that Obama gave us with the recovery Reagan gave us. Now, I was about your age during the Reagan, during the late 1970s, when the economy was really horrible in the 1970s. We had very high inflation, very high unemployment. The economy, America was deindustrializing. Everybody thought Japan was going to take over the world and so on, and the U.S. was a empire in decline. And so everything was going wrong with the economy in the late 70s. So Reagan came in during a period, I mean, literally, we had 15% inflation in Jimmy Carter's last year in office. So, I mean, that's something a lot of you can't even relate to, right? Because you've never experienced anything like that. But literally, every time you would go to the store, things would be more expensive because the inflation was running out of control. And that was what Reagan took over. And you can see the economy grew much, much faster under Reagan than it did under Obama. In fact, almost 2.5 times faster. And the difference is this $3 trillion number. This is basically saying if Obama's recovery has been as strong as Reagan's recovery, we would have today the economy would be $3 trillion larger, which is a huge number, right? That's the equivalent of the entire aggregate output of Michigan, Ohio, and Pennsylvania combined is $3 trillion. That was missing from the economy. And what makes this comparison kind of interesting to me as an economist, as economists, we like to compare and contrast things. And what makes this comparison interesting is that Reagan and Obama both took office during horrible, horrible economic periods in the American economy. And what makes it also interesting is that Reagan's philosophy was cut taxes, cut regulations, get government off the back of businesses, restore sound money, and so on and so forth. I mean, in one sentence, Reagan said very, very famously in his last debate, his only debate with Jimmy Carter, which was 1 week before the election, he said to the American people, government is not the solution, government is the problem. That was Reaganomics in one sentence. Obama, when he came in, I mean, basically his philosophy was almost entirely opposite, right? Whatever the problem is, there's a government solution. There's a government program or a government regulation or something that's going to solve these problems. So think about what we live with under. You know, people always say, well, what was so horrible? Why were businesses, you know, hunkered down in the fetal position during the Obama years? I mean, think what they lived under. First of all, you had the big tax increases under Obama. Then you had Obamacare, which is a total disaster. And then you had the massive increases in debt, where we increased the national debt by almost $10 trillion in the last 2 years of Bush and the 8 years of Obama. You had, remember, I don't know how many of you remember this, Obama saying you didn't build that, the small business son and woman. There was a kind of anti-business fervor under Obama, and these companies and businessmen and women had just gotten smashed down. As my friend Jeb Henserling says, you know, what happened on November 7, 2016 is the beating stopped. You know, I think there's a lot of truth to that. Businesses have been beaten down, and that liberation from those bad policies has led to a very strong recovery. So the next thing I'll show you is why do we need a strong economy? You know, how many of you in this room would say that you're worried about the national debt? I hope every hand, you know, is raised as a result of that. You can see what happens again. The last 2 years of Bush and the first 8 years of Obama, we had a massive increase in federal borrowing. This was the Keynesian. How many of you know what Keynesian economics is? A lot of you do. This is this bankrupt idea that somehow government spending is going to cause a rebirth of the economy, that it's going to have a stimulus effect. And you had this massive, massive borrowing. You know, we went from $10 to $20 trillion on the national debt. And this is measured, by the way, as a percentage of GDP. You can see we almost doubled the debt as a share of GDP. And the projection here, this is what we're looking at over the next 25 years. This is not my projection. This is the official, you know, referees, the Congressional Budget Office. They say over the next 20 years, our debt as a share of GDP will go to 150% of GDP. Now, that's a frightening number, right? I don't think the debt at 75% of GDP, it's not an imminent crisis. But if we go to 150% of GDP, yeah, that's problematic. Then the United States starts looking like Greece. Then the United States starts looking like Detroit, Puerto Rico, and so on, you know, governments that just completely crash because your debt gets so big that you're just raising revenues to pay off the people who buy the bonds. You're not even getting government services. So we can't allow this to happen, right? We can't allow this scenario to happen. Now, what is the major factor that is driving this bleak, bleak forecast for higher debt over the next 20 years? Huh? Entitlements, right? Entitlements. The Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, welfare programs, and so on, these what we call the automatic spending programs. And this is a result. Now, why are these programs rising so rapidly? Because we're aging. You know, this is America is an aging society. I'm a baby boomer, right? I was born in 1960. There are almost 75 million baby boomers. So we're the biggest. I think the millennials may be bigger than the baby boomers, but there are a lot of us. There's 75 million of us. We're living longer, right? A lot of us are going to live into our 80s and 90s, and we're going to retire at the age of 65. That means, you know, you're going to be when you work. A lot of you are working, but when you stop school and you're working full time, that means, you know, 10 to 15 to 20% of your paycheck is just going to go to be paying people like me who are going to be living in Palm Springs and so on, and you're going to be sending checks to us. And this is a big problem because by around 2030 or so, there's going to be two of you working for every retired person. So that's a very, very heavy burden that's being placed on you. So we can't allow this to happen. Now, the other factor that drives these debt numbers, though, is that the Congressional Budget Office is projecting very low growth of the economy. They don't think the economy can grow fast as it has in the past. And what we did, I remember I did this for the Wall Street Journal. And I showed Trump this, and he was, you know, he loved this. And I said, you know, sir, you know, 1.9% growth, which is what the CBO is telling us, if we get like 3.1% growth, which is still less than the international average, I mean, the average that we've had for the last 100 years is about 3.3. I said, if we can just get the growth rate up to 3%, and I'm not shooting for the moon here, you know, 3% is not a, you know, massive, forecast. I said, look what happens to the debt. It goes down every year. It doesn't go up. So the point of this is that if you want to solve problems in America, whether it's, you know, the debt, whether it's our budget deficit, whether it's the financing for infrastructure, improving our schools, ending poverty, all of that is contingent on getting the economy moving faster. By the way, all of these liberal economists, I remember day after day after day, we told Trump, you say to the American people, we're going to get 3 to 4% growth. I never forget this. You know, we used to drill this into Trump. And the first time we told him that, he'd go, I would say, we think if you do all your policies, you can get 3 to 4% growth. And this is typical Trump. He'd go, I want 5% growth. You know, now I don't think we can get 5, but guess what? We're going to get a number for the second quarter growth rate in 2018. It's going to come out in the next week or two. You heard it first here. It's going to be somewhere between 4.5% and 5%. That's amazing. Yeah, that's an amazing number, right? I mean, that's just one quarter, but that's a phenomenal achievement. Now, every economist, not nearly every academic economist at Harvard and Yale and Columbia, and you know, people like Larry Summers and people like Paul Krugman and all these people said, that's impossible. Donald Trump is lying to the American people when he said we can get, you know, 3 to 4% growth. It's impossible. We can't do that. My goodness, how could the Messiah couldn't get us 3 to 4% growth. How is this bumbling idiot Donald Trump going to do that, right? That was their attitude. Well, we're at 3% growth now, and I think we're going to get higher growth to come. So that's very good news. Moving ahead, I just thought I'd show you this. You know, because you guys don't, you know, you're so young. I love that. And that's why I love talking to you. You know, this is the stock market of the last 50 years. And I just wanted to let you see what's going on. You know, this is the green line is the stock market adjusted for inflation. And look at what happened in the 70s. Look at that. Because we had high inflation erodes the value of assets, right? The stock market crashed. And this was like worse than almost the worst crash in the stock market since the Great Depression. And it lasted for 15 years. And then Reagan comes in. If you don't think policy matters, I mean, look at this. Reagan comes in 1981, and the stock market for 20 years just goes through the roof. By the way, it went up even faster under Clinton. Clinton was a very pro-growth new Democrat. I wish there were Bill Clinton Democrats left in the party, but there just aren't. But Bill Clinton cut the capital gains tax. We had welfare reform. We had free trade agreements. We had balanced budgets. You know, and look at that. I mean, the American economy just soared in the 80s and 90s. Look at what the last, you know, under Bush and Obama, you know, it just hasn't been, the economy, even with the surge in the stock markets, is back where it was in 2000. So we've still got a lot of room to grow. But this is amazing, isn't it? This Reagan effect. I mean, it shows what happens when you get the policies right. By the way, again, because you guys are, you know, most of you weren't even born when Ronald Reagan was president, but there's a rewriting of history right now that's going on about Reagan. Reagan was a failure. He ran up the deficit and da-da-da. It's nonsense. Ronald Reagan rebuilt the American economy and won the Cold War, which was, that's why I think he does belong on Mount Rushmore, and so that's a good one. So, I'll show you some of the things. There are three things we tried to do, under Trump to get the economy moving again. But by the way, let me step back a minute. So I have this book coming out in September, which I hope every one of you will buy, that I wrote with Art Laffer called Trumponomics. And so what I'm talking about is what's in this book. And we have a big chapter about what is Trumponomics. Because Trump is not an ideological conservative. He is not. I mean, Ronald Reagan was an ideological conservative. He believed fervently in the free market. Obama was a ideological liberal, right? Donald Trump is not an ideological person. He doesn't look at the world through these prisms of, you know, conservative, you know, moderate liberal. He's just a common sense person. Now, the good news is that because of most of the things that we believe in as conservatives are common sense, Trump has signed off to them because, I mean, what we believe in makes sense and what they believe in doesn't make sense. And so, number one, he believes, but here's the thing that I think is so critical about Trump, and this is why I love him. Donald Trump is a businessman. He knows how businesses work. Now, I'm not here to trash Barack Obama, and there's a lot I liked about Barack Obama. But Barack Obama was a community organizer. He didn't know anything about business. He was completely vacuous in terms of his understanding of business. He'd never met a payroll. So that is different. So what happened in this election was we replaced an anti-business president with a pro-business president. And it matters. And so what did we do? Well, one of the first things we told Trump to do is get rid of the regulations. Get government off the back of businesses and let them succeed. Now, we're not saying get rid of the Clean Air Act or the Clean Water, workplace safety or things like that. But just get rid of the stupid regulations to make our economy grow faster. And look at that. I mean, that's a big reduction. So we've seen a 35% reduction in regulations under Trump. This is one of my favorites. This is awesome. This is Time Magazine's cover from like 4 months ago. And they meant this as a insult, right? But we love this. Yes, wrecking balls. We're just destroying every building in Washington, every regulation. That's why we're here, right? We're trying to make Washington a small, sleepy southern city again. These are the wrecking balls. Yes, we're wrecking the regulations. We're wrecking the massive bureaucracy and so on. And so I just love this because that's why Donald Trump won. That's why people wanted Trump to be president. So he would dismantle, as they say, dismantling government. They see that as a bad thing. Most America, I hope all of you see that as a good thing, because I sure do. So I love that thing. Okay, the next one is just trade. We can talk a little bit more about this. I don't want to talk too much about it now. But one of my points that I've made many times to Donald Trump, by the way, I'm a free trader. I hope that you are all free traders too. I mean, free trade is one of the pillars of prosperity. International trade is something that's good for both countries, obviously. But one of the points that Donald Trump makes that I think is, he's persuaded me of this. By the way, I have to say, this guy, who's not an economist, he's taught me a lot about economics. One of the things he said is, look, Steve, because Larry Kudlow and I, we used to say, Donald, you're a protectionist. You're a trade protectionist. He said, no, I am not. He said, I am not a trade protectionist. He said, I understand free trade. Of course, when two countries trade, it's a good thing for both countries. But he'd say, I want fair trade. It has to be, what's the term he uses? Reciprocal. You'll hear him say that word a lot. Reciprocal. That is, if we reduce our trade barriers, the other countries have to reduce theirs, right? He wants all these countries to reduce their trade barriers. At one point, you're not going to see this in the popular press because they love to beat up Trump, but look what country has the lowest tariffs. We do. Now, look, there's some countries like, Hong Kong that have lower tariffs than we do. By the way, if you want to see, a country why free trade is good, look at Hong Kong. I mean, Hong Kong has zero tariffs, a total free trade country, and it is one of the richest places on earth. It doesn't have any natural resources. So trade is important. But here's his complaint. The EU is at 5%, Korea is at 14%, China is at 10%. That's not fair trade, right? That's Trump's point. We reduce our trade barriers. They're supposed to reduce theirs, and they're not doing it. They're cheating. They're stealing. And here's where I think Trump has a point. Now, my fervent wish is, how is this trade, how are all these trade disputes going to be settled? And I hope they do get settled, because if he gets those settled, the sacrament is really going to go through the roof. Trump is using this leverage of America's, look, what is the greatest asset the United States has that every country in the world wants? Every single country, Japan, China, Germany, France, Spain, Italy, Canada, Mexico, what do they want? They want access to the American $15 trillion consumer market, right? What do Americans love to do? Buy things, right? That's what we do. And so this is, how did China get rich? They moved away from, obviously, communism, but we generated a lot of that growth by giving them access to the American market. That's when they were about a $6 trillion economy. Now they're about a $15 trillion economy. They're a big boy now, and Trump is saying, you're going to have to open up your markets to us. And so my bottom line here is, I believe what Trump wants is for the average, this average, to come way down so that they buy our stuff and we buy theirs. And I think Trump ultimately is going to prevail on this. I think it may take a while, but I think Trump is going to win. So energy, I'm just going to go through this quickly. The big story of the U.S. economy over the last 10 years is the energy boom. How many of you live in Texas? I mean, what's going on in Texas is phenomenal. I was just in the Permian Basin. I mean, anywhere you can stick a stick in the ground, they're drilling for oil and gas out there. Great headline in the newspaper on this is the Trump effect, that for the first time in 50 years, guess what country is producing the most oil and gas? United States of America. How awesome is that? First time in 50 years. We are, and by the way, we have surpassed Saudi Arabia, we've surpassed Russia. This is a great news story. And by the way, this is, I love this economic lesson because, you know, it's not as if God just in the last 10 years endowed with America with all this oil and gas, right? It's not like we waved a wand and all of a sudden it was there. That oil and gas has been there for hundreds of thousands of years. This is a story of America innovation, ingenuity, entrepreneurship, and so on, where basically the whole story here is four words: shale, oil, and gas. And we finally figured out how to crack through the, you know, shale rock formations that are 2 miles deep through horizontal drilling, through fracking. It's allowed us to massively increase our output of oil and gas. I hope there's nobody in this room who believes that America's running out of oil and gas, right? You know, when I was debating a liberal the other day and he said that, he said, well, we can't just drill our way out of this. We're running out of oil and gas. I'm like, we're not running out of oil and gas. We're running into it big time, big time. So, you know, we have, look at what's happened to the American production of oil and gas. I mean, we've almost doubled our production. It's a great, great story of economic achievement. By the way, every time we drill a barrel of oil here in Texas, anybody here from Oklahoma by any chance? Anybody here from, you are, okay, where? Well, what's going, Oklahoma's awesome. I mean, what's going on there? Anybody, I doubt it, anybody here from North Dakota? Anybody here from Pennsylvania? I mean, Pennsylvania is now an energy capital with, you've got the Marcellus Shale natural gas. I mean, it's a great story. I don't know, and I doubt anybody here from West Virginia or Illinois or Ohio. Where are you from, Illinois?
Southern Illinois.
Really. Southern Illinois? Yeah. Okay, because I'm from the Chicago area. But, you know, I mean, we produce a lot of coal. Where are you from? What?
Chicago.
Chicago, yeah. So, you know, Illinois is, my advice to you is get out of Illinois. I got out. No, I love Chicago, but it's what's going on there politically is a disaster. But anyway, we're producing all this oil and gas. We have a lot of it. I'll show you this. I love this chart. So look at, here's our increase in production, and here's our imports. So every time we drill another barrel of oil in Oklahoma or Texas or North Dakota, anybody here from Alaska, I doubt it, you know, Alaska, every time we produce more, we actually have to import less. So our trade deficit goes down. Think of the jobs that are being created. Think about this from a foreign policy perspective. You know, where do the terrorists get their money? Gee, I wonder where they get their money. They get it from petrodollars, right? They get it from the OPEC nations. If we can put the OPEC nations out of business by becoming, you know, the new OPEC, you know, I call this, the chapter of our book on energy is called Saudi America. Because in the 21st century, the United States is going to be the energy, you know, the energy producer of the world. Again, just a little fun story about Trump. I remember I'm showing him this stuff, and I said, you know, Donald, because this was before he was president, I said, and if we do this, and you're all in on American energy production, and I'm not talking about windmills and solar panels, I'm talking about using our, you know, massive fossil fuel resources. I said, you know, by the end of your first term, Mr. President, you can be, we can make America energy independent. And what he said to me? Steve, I don't want America to be energy independent. I want America to be energy dominant. And we are getting closer to that point. I love that. So I always talk about energy dominance now. More output leads to lower prices. That's a good story. Wind and solar, I mean, anybody who, there's these dingbats. Anybody California here? I mean, my God, what are you people doing? I mean, California actually has a lot of oil and gas. You've got a lot of energy. And then you're forcing people to put solar panels on the roof and all this stuff. I mean, look. Anybody want to take a guess? In 2017, what percentage of American electricity and energy came from solar power? Take a guess.
1%.
How did you know? 1%. Now we're up to about 1.5%. We get about 4% from wind. So we get 5% of our energy from wind and solar. 5%. What are we talking? Where does the other 95% come from? I mean, you know, most people. I bet a lot of your colleagues are thinking, oh, let's go green. Let's do green energy. And I always ask these kids, you know, when you, like, at good schools, Duke, Harvard, Northwestern, you know, Columbia, I say, where do you get your electricity from? And they go, well, duh, we stick the thing in that little socket there and the power comes out. I mean, people are so, they have no idea where their electric power comes from. What is the number one source of electric power production today? Well, that's a kind of trick question. Coal and natural gas are almost exactly tied at about 35%. So 70% of our electricity comes from wind, from not wind and solar, but from natural gas and from coal. And the left wants to get rid of those, right? I mean, can you think of anything more, truly more subversive to American? We are a $20 trillion industrial economy. Is there anybody in this room who really believes we're going to be able to power a $20 trillion industrial economy with windmills and solar power? It's insane. It's craziness. It's subversive to think that. I mean, look, there's advances being made in renewable energy, and we might be able to get up to, say, 20%, you know, in the next 20 years. But, you know, 50%? I mean, you would put the American economy out of business. Now, what your liberal friends are going to say is, we can't produce more fossil fuels because we're going to cause more pollution, and the entire planet is going to melt away. Well, first of all, as we've increased our American energy output, these are the pollution levels. These are real pollutions, by the way. These are things like, carbon monoxide. By the way, carbon monoxide is a pollution. Carbon dioxide is not a pollution. You don't get sick from breathing carbon dioxide, right? Carbon monoxide, if you breathe too much carbon monoxide, you die. Lead, obviously, is a pollutant. Nitrogen dioxide is a pollutant. Sulfur dioxide is a pollution. Look at this. These pollution levels have gone down 60, 70, 80%. Now, carbon dioxide, because the left is completely obsessed with carbon dioxide. By the way, without carbon dioxide, there is no life on Earth. I think most of you know that. But they said there's way too much carbon dioxide. Now, here's an amazing statistic that you could use when you're debating your liberal friends. Over the last 10 years, of all the industrialized countries, Australia, France, Germany, Spain, Mexico, Canada, India, all of these countries, which country do you think has reduced its greenhouse gas emissions the most? Anybody want to take a guess? USA. USA. You should be stunned by that. I'm not surprised that you're stunned by that. How would you know that? The media never reports that, right? How could the United States be reducing our carbon emissions? We never did the Kyoto Treaty. We pulled out of the Paris Treaty. We don't have a cap and trade system. We don't have carbon taxes. All these things that these, you know, sanctimonious European countries have done, we did none of that. Anybody? Now, here's your bonus gold star, if anyone can tell me the answer. How is it that the United States has reduced our carbon emissions so much? Not you. Not you. What? Innovation? Yeah. What innovation?
Technological.
What? Okay, yes, but what? What are we using more of today than ever before?
Natural gas.
So when we frack, I have this great bumper sticker on my car that says, fracking reduces global warming. It drives every liberal crazy, but it is true. The more you frack, the more natural gas you get. The more natural gas you get, the less carbon you put in the atmosphere, because natural gas, think about it, natural gas is the ultimate wonder fuel. It's cheap, it's abundant, it's made in America, it's reliable, and it is clean burning. And yet the left hates natural gas too, right? So they're just against anything that works, and they're for the things that don't work. Okay, now, I'm gonna come to an end on this because I've talked too much and I wanna hear what's on your mind. But I wanna just show you a couple more points. This capitalism 101, that's what this is. How many of you have seen this before? Raise your hand. Almost all of you have. Okay, if you haven't, then this was probably made 15, 20 years ago. But I love this. I just love this because I was in Seoul, South Korea exactly this time last year. This is Seoul here, by the way. Here's Seoul. What this is, for those of you who have not seen it, this is a satellite photograph of Korea at night. And this is the ultimate testament in one picture to the superiority of capitalism and free markets over socialism, communism, Bernie Sandersism, whatever you want to call these things. They're all the same. They're more about government control of the economy versus free markets. And, you know, what's so interesting, by the way, the white areas obviously are areas where you have electric power generation, where you have lights at night, right? Look at North Korea. This is Kim Il-sung's castle. It's the only thing that's lit up, right? I mean, it's just amazing. And the whole place is in the dark. Look at Korea. I mean, that's stunning. Now, here's why I love this so much. Economists always have debates about, you know, why one country gets rich and another country doesn't. You know, why is the United States rich and Mexico not so rich? Or why is Hong Kong a rich place and not, China, and so on and so forth. And, you know, people will go, oh, well, it's because one country has more natural resources, or one country has more access to this or that, or one country has blah, blah, blah. you know, one country has a different culture than the other, et cetera, et cetera. There's all sorts of different explanations for all this stuff. But what's so great about this is North Korea and South Korea are the same in every way, right? They are exactly the same in every single way. They are geographically the same. They're on the same peninsula. They have the same culture. They have the same language. They have the same history. They have the same resources. Everything is the only thing that's different about these two places is, and by the way, this is just a little artificial line in the sand. That's all this is. You know, they just said, okay, you have socialism over here, we'll have free markets over here. And look at that. I mean, and the only thing that's different is that this is socialism and this is capitalism. So why is it that so many of your colleagues want to move us towards North Korea? I mean, it's the most insane thing. I mean, so free market capitalism is the ultimate path to prosperity. Okay, I'm going to kind of give you one more thing that I just think kind of is fun. States, you know, okay, how many of you live in Texas and Florida? Okay, so about six or seven of you. Congratulations. You live in a states that are absolutely booming. How many of you live in South Carolina, North Carolina, Georgia, in the South? How many, a lot of you are, the big story of what's happening in America that liberals cannot come to grips with is that the red states are beating the hell out of the blue states. And so every day in America, 1,000 people are moving out of blue states like how many people live in New Jersey, New York, or Connecticut? Sorry, you know, it's just not good there. It's not good. I mean, New York, New Jersey, Connecticut, California, my home state of Illinois, we're just in the crapper right now. We're losing people and so on. And if you look at the four biggest states, Texas, Florida, New York, and California, you know, one out of every four Americans lives in these four states. So these states have a huge impact on how the American economy does as a whole. And look at this, just over the last 10 years, Texas and Florida, Texas is the biggest success story ever. Texas has gained 1.5 million people from other states in the last 10 years. That is to say, 1.5 million more Americans moved to Texas than moved out of Texas. That's like one of the biggest migrations ever in history. 800,000 people moved into Florida from other states. And then look at poor New York and California. I mean, this is just pathetic. New York has lost 1.4 million more residents than came into the state. And California, again, raise your hand if you're California. How do you screw up California? I mean, California is like a slice of heaven, right? I love California. Beautiful beaches, beautiful mountains, beautiful weather, beautiful women. I mean, what's not to like about California? It's an incredibly great place. And yet this cascade of bad policies has made California unlivable for a lot of people. Most of the people are moving out of California, by the way, are middle-class people. California is the ultimate income disparity state of rich and poor. In California, you've got a lot of really rich people, a lot of poor people. And by the way, people, I always ask people, well, why is it that people are moving to the South? And they go, oh, they're moving there in the South because of the weather. Well, wait a minute. California has the best weather in the country, and people are moving out of there. And they're moving to North Dakota, by the way. I mean, do you think people move from California to North Dakota for the weather? I mean, if you do, you've never been to North Dakota. So that's an amazing thing. And this is going on, and this is a big disadvantage. The big states that are going to get clobbered, in my opinion, in the next 5 to 10 years are California, New York, Connecticut, New Jersey, Illinois, and Minnesota. Those states are in big, big, a world of hurt. And these states like Texas, Florida, Arizona, Tennessee. Anybody here from Tennessee? Woo. Wow, is Tennessee booming. Yeah. Are you from Nashville or?
Nashville.
Woo! Nashville is like, every time I go, I mean, it's amazing. It's a mecca, and you know, they're all coming from all over the country. Tennessee, by the way, what is the same about Texas, Florida, and Tennessee? No income tax. So there are 9 states in the United States with no income tax. There are Texas, Florida, Tennessee, New Hampshire, Washington State, Nevada, South Dakota, and one or two others, Wyoming. And those states are growing a lot faster than the high tax states. I thought that you'd have fun with this. We rate the states in terms of which states have the best economic climate. There's nobody here from Utah, is there? So the Mormons we've done this 10 years in a row. Wow, they just do it right. They're number one every year. Any Hoosiers? Yeah. You moved, where are you from?
I'm from Southside Chicago, and now I live in North Carolina.
Okay, well, you guys got it right. I mean, you've had 2 great governors in a row, and Mike Pence, and who was the one before that? Mitch Daniels. So, you know, leadership matters. How many Tar Heels? Yeah, I mean, North Carolina's doing great. You know, Tennessee's awesome. These are the states. And then look at this. This is so sickening. These states are just stuck in the bottom for, you know, Illinois, Minnesota, Connecticut, California, New Jersey. Finally, I'll just show you the Trump effect, and then we'll take some questions from you. Lower taxes mean more revenues. We did this big tax cut. And then just this is kind of a fun one. Look at these effects of Trump. So look at just what's happened to manufacturing, mining, and construction jobs. Just since Trump was elected, we've gained 800,000 new manufacturing, mining. These are those blue-collar jobs that have been leaving the United States. They're coming back big time. Lowest, I love this one. You know, our racist president has created the lowest black unemployment rate ever. Black labor force participation up. Latino unemployment rate, the lowest ever. This is our president who hates Latinos. Boy, he's done a lot for the, look at this. This is literally the week after the election. Look at what happened to consumer confidence. You don't think that the people were psyched up about a pro-business president? And then look at this. This is the percentage of Americans who think the economy is good or great. Under Obama, the highest it got was 37%. Today, 70% of Americans rate the economy as good or great. That's a fabulous number. I'm almost getting tired of winning. You know, the Dow Jones, blah, blah, blah. So it's a good news story. I mean, look, Trump is not perfect. There are a lot of things that he does that I think his dalliances with Russia and so are just god-awful. I hate what he's doing with Russia. But, you know, when it comes to the economy, what Trump is proving is free markets and pro-business policies work. So I'm going to stop there. Thank you very much for your kind attention. And I think we got, like, five. Not you. You've asked to. No, I'm just teasing. I'll take as many as I can. And you just tell me when you guys want to stop. So go ahead. But you got to tell me where you're from and all that.
So my name's Doyle. I attend Hillsdale College, but I'm originally from my home state is Georgia. My question is there anybody in the Trump administration that's serious? Because Republicans often criticize President Obama for increasing the national debt, but the debt keeps going up, yeah, crossing the $21 trillion mark under Trump administration.
You know, the head of the budget office, a guy named Mick Mulvaney. I love Mick Mulvaney. He's an awesome, awesome budget director. He's puts forward a lot of great budgets. Unfortunately, there's not a lot of desire to cut these government spending programs. Now, I'm going to throw out an idea for you because I think this is really so important for your generation to get behind. Social Security is probably the worst investment you're ever going to make in your life, right? The joke is on your generation. We've accumulated these huge debts. We spent all this money. We have trillions of dollars of unfunded liabilities, of money that's going to go to the baby boomers and so on. And you all are going to be stuck with the bill. And if you think that you're going to get Social Security when you retire, you know, I think you're living in a fantasy land. Now, what I want to do, and this is not a new idea, but I think it's more important now than ever, is basically say to every American under the age of 30, you, instead of having to take 12% of your paycheck, each paycheck, and send it to Washington, you put that money into a forced saving account under your own name. It's called like a personal IRA, like a personal 401k plan. And you get to accumulate that money over time. And you basically can't spend it, by the way. You can't tap into that money until you reach the age of 65. But if you have that kind of system and we get an average return on the stock market, that means that every single one of you in this room is going to have at least $1 million in that account by the time you retire. And by the way, that means you could actually take out the money and you have a higher benefit than you would get Social Security, and you can leave $1 million to your kids. So how many of you like the idea of doing that? Rather than, I hope every year. Now, you know, when I was growing up in the 60s, there were rallies, you've seen this in the movies and stuff, where the 60s generation, the people your age, what were they protesting about in the 1960s? What?
Vietnam.
The Vietnam War, right? We had a draft back then. And my brother was of draft age. Nobody wanted to be drafted to go over to Vietnam. And so, remember, you've seen these on the videos and stuff. They had huge rallies of young people in the 60s, and they would go to the Capitol Hill, and they'd come to the monument area and the mall, and they would basically, remember, they'd say, you know, hey, what did they say? Hell no, we won't go. Hell no, we won't go. And they would burn their draft cards. That's what they did. That was we're not going, we're going to burn our draft cards. What I want to see from your generation is hundreds of thousands of people your age going to the Capitol and yelling, "Hey, hey, we won't pay," and burning your Social Security cards. You know, can you guys have a movement starting like that? So that's the way to solve the entitlement problem. Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Catherine Francois. I go to Benedictine College in Atchison, Kansas.
Sorry, which college?
Benedictine College.
Where's that?
Atchison, Kansas.
Okay, got it.
And I study econ and poli sci. My question was about, so you had the graph where you showed the economic growth under Reagan and various other presidents. So one of my professors had us read Paul Krugman's book, Peddling Prosperity. Paul Krugman's book, Peddling Prosperity.
He actually had you read that book?
Yeah.
You know what? You know what, Paul Krugman? I want to show you something before you even continue with this. So this is what happened to the stock market. This is election day. Paul Krugman went on MSNBC the morning after the election. You can look this up. And he said, he was asked, when will the stock market recover now that Donald Trump is president? And he said, never. We've had the biggest bull market. That guy knows nothing. He's an idiot. Anyone who's ever followed his advice, I mean, why does people take him seriously, really? I mean, everything that he's ever said has been wrong. He made his grand prediction. He told people to sell stock here. We've had a 38% increase in the stock market since then. So, you know, I mean, it's like, you know, a hitter that hits 190, and you go, hey, let's send him to the All-Star game. Okay, but anyway, go ahead.
So he makes the argument that if you look at the peak-to-peak growth during the Reagan years, that doesn't actually, not above
that's ridiculous.
The upward trend. I mean, I was just wondering if you could elaborate on he got the data for that.
Peak-to-peak growth. Look, when Reagan took office in 1981, I'll show you this again. Now, this is just the stock market, but it's a pretty good indication of what was going on with the overall economy. Sorry, I'm just going back because I want to find this. It's an important point. So this is, Reagan comes in. This is where we were. You know, not peak to peak. We had the biggest, this is the greatest period of wealth creation and prosperity in the history of civilization. Now, does Paul Krugman really think that happened by accident? The whole point of what I'm trying to tell you is policy matters, right? Liberals probably like to pretend that it doesn't really matter what Washington does. Yeah, it matters a whole heck of a lot what Washington does. When you get the policies right, you know, as we used to tell Trump, Larry used to say this, you know, all of the, under Obama, all of the policy dials were twisted to anti-growth. And Trump has come in and all he's done is twisted them the other way. And by doing that, you get this huge, huge rush of growth. Now, it was people like Paul Krugman and Larry Summers and all these others who said the economy, that the economy is going to go into recession, you know, if Trump was elected. And also they said it's running out of gas. And we said it's not running out of gas. The economy is so low that Trump's going to come in and it's going to be like, we used to use the analogy of taking a champagne bottle and shaking it up and taking the cork off it. I mean, I saw the president about a month ago over, he was at Mar-a-Lago. And, you know, I got an occasion to talk to him for about 3 minutes. And, you know, he's, Steve, can you believe this economy? Blah, blah, blah. You know, he's going, and I go, you know, I literally said, you know, Mr. President, this is working better than we thought it would. You know, we had it drafted on the draft. You know, we're going to do A, B, C, D, E. We're going to get all this growth. But even we didn't think it would be this strong. And now liberals who, you know, 2 years ago said, oh, well, this is just the reason the economy is surging is the Obama effect. You know, and as I said to CNN last week, yeah, this is the Obama effect. The effect that Barack Obama is no longer president. That's why we've got this growth going. And so, you know, this is what, you know, but look, Reagan, I lived through it. The America, if I always say, when I get down on my knees and say my prayers at night, thank you, God, that Jimmy Carter was not reelected president in 1980. Because, you know, Carter was like a malaise, the economy's going to hell. And Reagan just rebuilt the economy with tax cuts, sound money, deregulation, and pro-business policies. One more, and then we'll, I hope that helps. But do not listen to Paul Krugman, all right? Just evict him from.
I'm Ryan, I go to Indiana University, and I want to start off by thanking you. I've been taking a lot of heat for defending the fair trade argument.
I'm a free trader, but yeah. You know, look, am I nervous about it? Yes, I'm nervous about it. Trump is playing a high-stake game of poker right now. And if this doesn't work out, I mean, the economy would be booming even faster if it were. But my thing, because I'm so glad you brought this up. Look, do I think we should be picking a fight with Europe right now on trade? No. Do I think NAFTA should be renegotiated? Yeah. I mean, NAFTA is good for the whole North American continent. It has to be updated, but Trump is wrong. Remember what he said during the campaign? This is the worst trade deal in the history of civilization. No, it was Ronald Reagan's vision that we would have a free trade, arrangement for the whole North American continent. He was right about that. Now, there are things that have to be fixed, yes, but is the worst trade deal ever? No. But what I agree with Trump on, I think this is really a critical point. I'm sorry to interrupt. I will take your question, but look, what is the country that is the problem for the, what is our biggest sinister country in the world today?
China.
And, China is the problem, right? And China is, Trump gets it that they're cheating, that they steal $350 billion of our technologies every year. I didn't say 350 million, I said 350 billion. They steal our drugs. They steal our vaccines. They steal our pharmaceutical products. They steal our computer software. They steal our entertainment. They steal our music. They steal everything that we have. They don't honor our patents. They don't honor our copyrights. And look, most of you, because you're smart people, you're conservatives, right? Most of you, what you're going to probably do when you go into the workforce is you're going to develop intellectual property. You're going to innovate and new things and so on. Well, how can we do that if every other country starts stealing from them? So, in my opinion, Trump cannot get tough enough with China. And people say, well, why is he picking us to fight with China? And my point is, either we're going to fight this fight with China right now on trade, or we're going to have a hot war with China in 10 years. Mm-hmm. And we better win this one. And I'll tell you this, knowing Donald Trump, and this is very good news, he is not going to back down on this fight with China. Isn't that good news? He's not going to back down with China, and he's going to win. Because you know what? The United States stock market has been going up the roof. Have you seen what's going on in China? Nobody reports this. China's stock market is down 20%. You know why? China, and nobody, I get so upset with people in the media. It's like they're rooting for China. They hate Trump. What's the old saying? Liberals hate Trump more than they love America. And it's true. They're rooting for China against the United States in this trade war. But the problem is if Trump backs down, you're going to see more military action by China and so on. So what Trump is basically saying, and he's right about this, China needs the United States more than we need them. And so that's where we're at. If he can get this settled, as I said, I think you're going to see fairer trade and you're going to see the stock market go through. But anyway, I'm sorry.
Amen.
Yeah.
My question is, now, I like you, but I'm no fan of the baby boomers. And in my opinion,
I don't like the millennials too much, so we're even, right?
This is Generation Z. Here,
oh, you're anyway, a Generation Z, okay.
So, in my opinion, one of the biggest sins of the baby boomers was shrinking the American family and starting the decline of the American family. And I want to get your opinion on how much of America's growth is threatened by the crisis
that
the American family sees themselves
in. So there's an old saying that demographics is destiny. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of truth to this. And, I'm trying to remember the birth rate last year in the United States, I think hit like a record low.
Yeah.
That's a problem. Children are our future. I mean, we need to have more children. And by the way, this is why, the scourge of abortion and things like this is so tragic, because we need people to have, now look, I'm not, people, I believe, that people should have choices about, how many kids they want. I don't want the government telling people how many kids they have. But yeah, I grew up in a family of five kids, and this was in the 60s. We were considered like a middle-sized family back then. Now, people, if you see, I have a friend who has four kids, and, these four kids, they're all under 6 years old, and these people come, don't you understand birth control and stuff? I mean, they're like, people are so insulting to people who have a lot of kids. But I love growing up with a big family. Yes, we need to have more children. I mean, this is one of the restraints on growth right now, because, growth is related to how much productivity you have and the growth of the labor force. One of the things that Trump is running up against is there's 6 million more jobs in the economy today than there are people that fill them. Did you know that? Mm-hmm. I mean, how many of you in this room work, have a job? Work, well, you're in college, work. I mean, one of the cool things, I do a lot of this work on when you're looking at the evidence about what predicts how successful you will be later in your life. And there's a lot of things that predict that, but one of the indicators is, the government's pretty clear on this. If you start working at a young age, you will be richer later in your life because you learn these work skills and so on at an earlier age. It's like when I was working at the Wall Street Journal, I was, that was one of my favorite jobs of all. I was the economics editor at the Wall Street Journal, and we would meet with really incredibly successful people, successful in finance or business or sports or science or entertainment, whatever the area was. And I used to always ask these people at these editorial board meetings, you know, where did you grow up? And I was amazed at how many of them said, oh, I grew up on a farm. How many of you grew up on a farm? Any of you? You start working at a young age, right? What time did you, how old were you when you start working? 12, right? 10. Yeah, you're clean. I mean, and you know, you learn a work habit at a young age. One of the problems with your generation is a lot of you don't start working till, you know, you're 18, 19, 20, 21, 22 years old. No, we want to get people starting to work when they're 15 years old because that pays off in the long run. But yes, we need more children. I hope you all, be fruitful and multiply. But there's also something else that we see. The United States has one huge demographic safety valve that almost no other country has. And what is that? How can we increase our population? Immigration, right? I mean, immigration is one of our great assets, right? I mean, yeah, they got to come in legally, but you know, we're a nation of immigrants. Immigrants are incredibly successful, talented people. You know, I hope that the right, our conservative movement is not turning against immigrants. This country was built on the basis of immigrants. We need immigrants. They're incredibly, they bring in fresh blood to this country. They're the hardest working people. And the Asians have been incredible. They're like the Jews of the early 20th century. And the most successful people who've ever come to this country are the Asians. We need the Mexicans, are incredibly hardworking people. You know, what I used to tell Trump is, yes, we need the wall, Donald, but make sure it has big gates so people can come in legally. And we need, you know, skilled people. We need talented people. You know, I'll just end this by saying this, you know, that I would submit to you that the number one issue for your generation is not global warming, and it's not, you know, Russia, and it's not, you know, who's going to be president, 10 years from now. The most important thing is this. What country in the world will be the economic superpower of the 21st century? And if you think about it, the 20th century was unquestionably the American century, right? We were the superpower throughout that century. I want the United States to continue to be the superpower for the next century because I think we're a force for good, not evil in the world. But for the first time, probably since the end of World War II, we do have an honest goodness rival in China. And don't kid yourself, China has their eyes on us, right? They want to surpass the United States. They want to supplant us from being the economic superpower. And I remember, you know, about right before I left the Wall Street Journal, about 3 years ago, we were visited by the economic minister of China. And he came in and said, our economy is booming. And he said, by the year 2021, we're going to surpass the United States, and we're going to replace you as the economic superpower. We're going to leave you in a cloud of dust. And I'll never, you know, and I just couldn't take it anymore because he cut me. I bleed red, white, and blue. So I said to this gentleman, sir, that's not going to happen. You know, China is not going to surpass the United States as the economic superpower. And he said, why is that? And I said, it's very simple. Because our Chinese are a lot smarter than your Chinese. But you know, this is what, you know, this is a formula of success. Yankee ingenuity combined with the smartest, most talented people from the rest of the world. They come here, and so I'm not too worried about not enough Americans. If you guys don't have enough babies, we can bring them in from other countries. Thanks, guys. Good luck to you. Thank you. Thank you.